You're watching a production of South Dakota Public Broadcasting.
We spent 156 days in an area called Sandbag Castle.
If we got shot at, we didn't know it, or we didn't want to know it.
I just grabbed him and hugged the ground tight, and boy, we took that round about 8 feet from us.
Those fragments hit me. I felt the concussion more than what entered my legs.
The Korean War was fought from 1950 to 1953 and pitted the United States, South Korea, and their UN allies against North Korea and the Chinese Communists. An estimated 25,000 South Dakotans served in the armed forces during the Korean War, and 160 died during the conflict. For some, the Korean War was their first wartime experience and their last. For others, just another chapter in a military career. But for all who served, Korea was an experience unlike any other in their lives. Here are some of their stories.
My name is Ron Morrow, and I served in the United States Marines from 1951 to 1953. My dad said, you got a letter from the President of the United States. That's a draft notice. At that time, we went to Sioux Falls, and a Marine came walking into the area, and he said, "I need 8 guys for the Marine Corps today." And I really liked his uniform better than the Army uniforms. So I put my hand up, and actually 8 of us, and we were in the Marine Corps.
My name is Dwight Dewey Morrow, they call me, and I served over in Korea with the 3rd Infantry Division, Heavy Mortar Company. I was drafted, and at the time I'd went to Yankton College 1 year, and when that broke out, and I wanted to join the Marines, and Dad wouldn't let me. And he wanted me to work in the cream station. We ran a cream and egg station, and I think back in those days, and that was hard work. And we bought a lot of cream and eggs, a lot of feed. And I wanted to get out of there and try something different.
My name is Edward Klasky, and I'm from Armour, South Dakota. This first ship I was on was the Valley Forge. A bunch of us fellas decided to join the Navy because the Korean War was going on, and so we thought, well, we didn't want to be in the Army. My dad was in the Navy, so I said, well, let's join the Navy. So we all got together, and quite a few of us that day from Armour went to here and joined the Navy.
Philip Konechny, and I was in the Army. I was assigned to a 105 Howitzer battalion, the Triple Nickel, which was quite well known in Korea. Inducted in 52 in Sioux Falls, South Dakota. And being a kid that was never away from home, I spent from then until the first part of January in Fort Sheridan, Illinois, and Camp Atterbury, Indiana. Everybody was gone over the holidays, and I was through Christmas all by myself. A couple, 3 other fellows away from home for the first time. That was pretty tough.
My name is Jerry Teachout. I was the World War II recallee. I was a second lieutenant, promoted to first lieutenant before I came home. We knew we were recalled for the Korean War. And in my case, I was already an instructor pilot in a type of airplane that we knew they were using in Korea, which was the C-46. And so when I went over there, there weren't enough C-46s to go around. We flew C-47s. And then finally, we got enough C-46s literally out of the junkyards.
We had pretty good planes when we left, but then the Marines needed some good planes, so they gave us some older planes. And they took the better Corsairs, and they gave us a bunch of old planes. But we got by, but we had a lot of tough luck with some of these planes. Some of them were just bad, you know. And during this 9 months, we lost every plane we had. And because some of them just, you know, crashed. But a lot of them got shot down like with small arms fire, you know. They flew real low ground support for the Marines.
I was assigned to the motor pool because I was quite mechanically inclined. That's what my test showed, that I was pretty good in mechanics. So they put me in motor pool. So I drove the motor pool NCO around, fixed Jeeps and trucks and stuff for the 105 Field Artillery Battalion for the triple nickel.
And I ended up over in Korea, and they asked me what my MOS was, my military occupation. I said, well, I'm an intermediate speed radio operator. Well, the guy taking care of me said, well, we don't need any radio operators. We got all kinds of them, you know. What else can you do? Well, I said, I've driven a truck. We got more than enough truck drivers. And he looked, shuffled some papers around. He said, I'm going to send you up with a heavy mortar company. I says, I never had any training during my basic training on mortars. Well, you'll learn, you know. It doesn't take long to learn. You know. So I got to be in the mortar company then.
My name is Earl Boxa, and my rank was a Sergeant First Class in the 45th Division, Company F, over in Korea. The boundary, the MLR we called the main line of resistance, that it went something like an S. It was higher in the east and a little lower in the west. So the straight line was kind of violated, so we landed right in there. We spent 156 days in an area called Sandbag Castle. That spot was only about 35 yards apart where the enemy was and where we were at Sandbag Castle. By that time, we had a few assignments to try to always go out and catch a prisoner on a patrol, but we never were successful to catch anybody. We'd get in firefights and have firefights with them, but we never could bring one home alive so we could say we had a prisoner of war or somebody we could visit with and check out and see what the intelligence would let us know.
I had a job I didn't like, kind of. You know, I was kind of small and skinny, so they would... sometimes these jets would come in and they'd have a hydraulic leak down in there by the engine. And I would fit down the duct, the air duct. But they'd have to put me in there when the engine was running. See, and I'd go in there head first. You'd have to go in there with your hands in front of you because there was no room to turn. And it was downhill in this tube. And you'd slide right down in there towards the motor. And you was about 20 inches from the pots there that are burning where the jet was running. You had to run it about 20%. So if there's a hydraulic leak, you can see where it's leaking in there, see? And I didn't like that job. And then, you know, you had to make sure the guy that was in the cockpit couldn't turn it up over 20%, because if he did, it collapsed your lungs, the air going through there so fast, you know? And then when you went to get out of there, you had to bag up like a fish out the back, and some guy would sometimes stand back there and put their hands against your feet just for the heck of it, you know? And you couldn't get out, and you wanted to get out so bad, you know? And I was guilty. I did that to my buddy once, you know, and it was so funny because when he come out, I was gone, you know, and he got so mad because you want to get out of there so bad, you know. But
they made me the forward observer, and a lot of times I'd have to go out on the point, they call it, with the Belgian troops, and they had a what they call a listening post about 200-400 yards out in front of the infantry, and you sat there all night listening for the Chinese to come toward us, you know, and you could hear them a lot of times, you know, and then they'd call fire missions, and and then we'd skedaddle back before dawn, get back in our positions, you know. And so did the Chinese. It was just kind of a game with both of us, you know. But it could be a deadly game too, you know. There was a couple guys killed while I was there, and with fire from the Chinese too. You know, they were doing the same thing.
We would have a turn at outpost, which is just like a listening post. You go out there and be real quiet and listen to see if you can hear anybody coming. And if they did, of course, we had telephones out there. We could call back in and report. We did have good communication line. There was communication wire all over that valley. We got so good at it, we could take a wire at night and feel it with our hands, and then we could strip it bare and tie another line on it so we could go farther in the dark, just without having the light to do it. We could just do it by feel.
Robert Fickbaum, a war dog outfit attached to 3rd Division, a volunteer outfit, night reconnaissance with big German shepherds. Hassel, H-A-S-S-O, a good German name for a German shepherd. What he was trained for was to go out there and lead this patrol, do this route, and keep them from getting ambushed, because the Chinese were famous for ambushing their patrols. They were smooth at night. They wore soft shoes, they didn't wear helmets, they wore padded suits, and they were good night fighters. And the GIs come stumbling along with their big boots and helmets and this and that, you know. And we were no match for them until we got dogs. And then we reversed it. The dog could pick them up at 200 yards, probably. And the patrol leader says, "What do we do now?" I said, "Well, we've got three options. We can sit down and wait for them to come out, or we can back up a ways, call in the artillery, or we can wait and see how many there are," which is what our patrol usually called for, is to find out what the Chinese are doing, how many are there, if they're bunching for an attack. That's our main objective, is find out if they're bunching for an attack. That's the reason you're out there at night, so you can give early warning to the line.
I believe I was the last C-46 in and out of Kimpo on the night of January 3rd, of 1951. I had been on a mission down in South Korea, and I did not know, nobody briefed us on what was going on around the home base, which was Kimpo. And I came back, it was, I suppose, 12 o'clock at night or something like this. We'd been flying all day and we were just dog tired. But I canceled instrument flight rules coming in from the south. Well, over the south part of Korea was relatively a safe area. And we had we knew this little tower operator. His name was Mickey, and I'd give anything if I'd had this tape. But we had a jingle, went something like this. "I'm turning on the base with my boots down and laced. Give me the nod and I'll put her on the sod." Well, now who would know what that meant, except a tower operator to a pilot? "I'm turning on the base leg, my boots are down and laced, my gear's down and locked," which you had to report anyway. "Give me the nod," you had to get the tower approval, "give me the nod, give me the approval, and I'll put her on the sod, I'll put her on the deck." Well, the Chinese wouldn't understand that. But he came back to me and in this lingo, and I was about 50 miles south of Kimpo. And I just broken out in the clear, and I could see that the whole base was on fire. I didn't know what was burning. And when I got closer, I could see across the river, there was a whole bunch of little tiny, I know now there were cooking fires. But those were the Chinese, just across the river. And he told me to land on the short runway, not the long runway, to keep it low and tight, and don't go across the river, because they were shooting at us. Now, it all came through clear in this lingo. I'd give anything today if I had that. And that's exactly what I did. I rolled it out level, and right at that time, I touched down. Well, I wouldn't do that anymore in a big airplane than a man in the moon, because it's. I guess it was safe in the day, but it was dark, and it's something that you did, and and I guess you forgot about it. But they asked me, I remember seeing the little fires over there. There were several airplanes that they were burning up. There were tents and piles of this, that, and the other thing on fire. And I rolled up in front of the operations tent and chopped the engine. They said, well, what in the hell are you doing here? And I said, well, I just got back to come back here from someplace I'd been down. Well, crank them things up and get it out of here. It's still flyable, isn't it? I said, probably said yes. So I cranked the thing up and away I go. No clearance or anything. Just get away from there. And the next day, of course, why, the Chinese came across the river and just decimated the base.
One time, I remember, a guy came in and he couldn't get his landing gear down. And they have emergency air bottles on them, so if the hydraulic don't work, they can pull a cable and it'll blow the gear down. Well, nope, somebody forgot to put air in the emergency bottle and it didn't blow the gear down. So it was in the winter time, and the pilot came flying by and he said, I can't get my gear down. He called down the ship and he said, I can't get my gear down. But he said, the captain says, what should I do? Well, the captain says, you put it in the water right by the ship and we'll get you out. And the pilot says, it's too cold. He said, I'm not going to do it. He said, I'm going to come on that ship. And the captain says, you come on this ship, you're going to lose your wings. He said, we're going to bust you. Well, he said, I got enough fuel to make about two more passes. He said, when I come in the second time, I'm coming in on that ship. And he did. He come right down the center without no landing gear, and he just tore the airplane all to pieces underneath. But and he hit that Davis barrier in front, a big nylon catcher. And he hit that, and he got out of the airplane. He said, I'm alive. And I never heard if he got court-martialed, and I never heard the results of that. But it probably didn't do nothing to him because they probably glad to get him back, you know. But that's one time he didn't follow orders. You know, he didn't. He said, I've seen too many pilots in this cold water. They don't last 5 minutes, you know, and them jets go down so fast. So I don't blame him, you know.
There was a position out in front of us called Sugarloaf. It was a little hill, and it was said to be well fortified with Chinese troops. Well, they were going to bomb that. The Navy was going to bomb it, the tanks were going to fire point blank at it, and they were down, they ended up that morning down in the valley over on our left. And there was probably 10 or 12 tanks, and the Navy come in about dawn with jets. I think they were Navy jets anyway. They came swooping in and they were shooting rockets and machine guns at this, we call it Sugarloaf Island. They were shooting all this stuff at the island, and the tanks were shooting at it. And one of the planes made a big swoop up and he come back again, and them Chinese gunners shot him down. Well, all the Belgian troops and the forward observers and stuff, we were standing up on top of a trench line or on the hill there, and all of a sudden a jet came from behind us. And I seen it coming, and I could see the 50 calibers coming out of the wings and striking close to us. And I yelled at the top of my lungs to hit it. And a couple of the other guys seen it just then too. And we all dropped into this trench, but it was in line with the plane coming down at us. Well, it was one of our planes. And he got a kid right next to me, a Belgian kid, went right through his back and out here, and hit his arm, and his arm was just hanging there. And the hole out here was about this big. And we grabbed, I took my first aid kit, and the Belgium sergeant and a couple other guys, we wrapped him up with, and hauled him down to the bottom of the hill, but he died before. We called the helicopter in him.
My name is Seb Axman. I was in the U.S. Army. I was in the 2nd Division, the Indian Head Division. We were in the mountains of Korea. I was the assistant gunner on a 50 caliber machine gun, and my job in a 50 caliber machine gun was to carry the extra barrel, which weighed like about 50 pounds. So, you know, at first you think, well, that ain't bad. But when you start carrying it up and down hills, it gets pretty heavy. The hills in Korea are quite, they're like the Black Hills. They're very steep hills. So you do a lot of climbing up and down, and that wasn't fun.
That part of Korea is very mountainous, much like the Black Hills. You go up one hill, go down, you go up another hill. Same kind of stuff. Tough climbing.
You ain't gonna tell anybody that's ever been in the war, if they weren't scared, they're telling you a lie because you're scared when you're in them positions. I think it was July, first part of July that I got captured. We was put up right on the front lines, which should have never been for a 105 outfit. And that was an awful night to talk about fireworks. They had all these flares and everything, and talk about droves of Chinese coming. They never kept coming. We just kept knocking them down. It was just piles of them. It's unbelievable unless you've been there. It's hard to visualize that. Then we seen we couldn't hold them anymore. We were supporting a rock division, which infantry division, which pulled out, which then the Chinese come right at us. Well, there wasn't enough of us manpower, so we had to leave because them 105 sure did stop, blow a big hole into a line of them, but they just come in droves, one fleet right after another. We run out of 50 caliber, or truckload of 50 caliber ammunition on a machine gun on a truck, and then we took off, and I got down behind that truck and a round come in. It was a chunk that come right over the top of my head, big as a dinner plate, went right through the side of the truck. And I was just below it. Well, then we took off up on top of the hill, and we thought we was going to be able to get away. And we got surrounded, and then a round come in and knocked me out, and I guess I rolled quite a ways down the hill. I don't remember, but the other boys helped me a lot.
A carrier is a very dangerous place to work on the flight deck because it's always, you got to keep your eyes open all the time. You know, you can't make a mistake up there. you know, we had guys, you know, these propellers were dangerous. It was sometimes they'd step into the jet blast and get burnt bad. And when they catapulted these planes, one day a fella got his arm caught when they shot the plane off and it tore his arm out right up here. And he didn't even know it till 5 seconds later, but he passed out, you know, the minute he, it just, like that, you know, it tore it right out.
It was hot. It was July. It was hot. We were sweating. One day at Chow, the captain of the company said, I think we'll send trucks to the shower point. So, of course, everybody got on trucks. And he sent a second truck. We got to the shower point, and as we were unloading at the shower point, something went boom on the truck that I was on. When those fragments hit me, I felt the concussion more than what entered my legs. I mean, that sounds funny, but the concussion on the bottom of my boot, and I just jumped, and I didn't know what happened. I thought somebody had shot in a mortar round from some position. So when I hit the ground, I just crawled to get away from the truck. My first thought was, if they hit that truck's gonna explode. So I just crawled. And then later, we determined that, no, it wasn't a mortar round, it was something on the truck. And then I thought, you know, well, yeah, I saw that sandbag. And, you know, at the point in time, I didn't realize grenades were in there, but that's what happened. And I just crawled and got out of there. Well, they took us. We were lucky that we were right across the road from this shower point in the MASH station. Just like what you see on TV, you know, the doctors were working on the people as fast as they could. And I know I got on the table and they worked on me. I think they just cut me open to try to take out as much as they could and stuffed me full of gauze to stop the bleeding. It was interesting. You know, just to realize how they handled you and kept moving you. And the doctor in Busan said, well, he took that gauze out again, and he says, well, we'll let the guys in Japan decide whether they want to dig deeper, because you get fragments in there, and they're going to come out naturally, you know, later on. And they did, you know, for 2-3 years later, every once in a while, you'd feel your leg, and sure enough, a little piece would be coming out.
I couldn't walk hardly because I had that shrapnel on my knee for 30 days. And when it's come out, see, we didn't have no medical attention much. A Band-Aid, that's all they'd give us. Well, when it started sticking out, they got a hold of a pair of pliers, and it was diamond-shaped, about the size of a quarter, and all there was just a little bit sticking out. I guess I passed out when they pulled it out. But I wanted that piece, and they throwed it away for me. I would like to have that for a souvenir, but...
The flying schedule was 12 on, 12 off. That's hours. And if your flight went in the next 12 hours, well, that was just tough. You still showed up to fly your mission when your 12 hours time came around. And we kept that up all the time that we were in Korea. We had to, because there wasn't any other airlift available. But our job was to stay with that airplane and go wherever they wanted us to. And that's exactly what we did.
When you work on an airplane, you have to check out everything you do on a plane. But we'd have like overnight, we worked day and night. Oh, we had night crews, I worked night crew a lot. And we worked from 8 in the afternoon till maybe 4 in the morning. And then we had midnight chow too. They served 4 meals on the ship. And I always thought the midnight chow was the best.
We had a little bunker. It was about 6 by 8. We made our own stoves. We got our own charcoal from the chogis that carried it up. And a sack of charcoal would last 2 days to keep the bunker warm. And we would cook our sea rations on a charcoal stove. And we had a 5-gallon bucket of water that we could have water up on the line all the time. And then we'd have one hot meal at noon, or supper. That'd be served anywhere from 2 to 7 o'clock at night. We changed the time, hoping that the enemy wouldn't know and wouldn't shoot any rockets in or drop any artillery.
Green tomato soup was one thing that they made for us. The first thing they told us when we got into prison camp at night, don't eat over one biscuit, because they don't fully cook it. Well, you get it in your stomach, and just like bread raising, it just bloats you up, so don't eat over one biscuit. Of course, we were hungry. We didn't get nothing to eat, really, all the time we was walking, very little. And they talk about fish heads and rice. That's no exception. It was food. You picked off the fish part of it. And then after a couple nights before we was going to be exchange, it was going to be real good to us. They got some canned duck. That was good. The duck was good, but they forget to take the feathers off of it. We had to pull the feathers off first.
The dog did save my life. The last great battle was fought right next to us. The 3rd Division was in there when we came, and the 2nd Division was just coming in when the Chinese attacked this rock division. And so the 3rd Division didn't even get into reserve before they put them behind the rocks or to stop them from running, because they just threw things down and run. Well, when the smoke cleared, kind of like, then they wanted a couple of their dog handlers back that they had for a long time, you know, to see what the Chinese are up to. Well, 2 of us got it called on that job, and I was one of them. So we went over there, and it was a mess, I should say. We had to go through the 3rd Division, where they were dug in. The day I got there, they'd been there for 6 weeks, and they had their first hot meal that day. Otherwise, they'd been on sea rations for 6 weeks, and they were lean and mean. But you had to go through them at night, and then you had to go through the rocks, and then you had the Chinese up where you were looking for it. And one is equally, they were just equally dangerous at night, you know. I was up in this mess, and we finally got as far as we could go, as our patrol called for. Didn't see any Chinese, nothing going on. So we stopped before we come back in, and we sent three guys up on this little hill. We were laying up against a side hill, small hill, and see if there's anything up over the hill before we move on, you know, don't move into something. And I don't know if the Chinese saw them or whether they had a listening device or what they had up there, but they were on the other side of the hill. They probably weren't over 400 yards from us, you know. But small mortar rounds started coming in. And they hit a man in our patrol, in the back of the patrol. I looked over at this big German Shepherd, and he's digging. Well, I'd been with him long enough, you know, that I knew him quite well, and I knew this next round is ours. I just grabbed him and hugged the ground tight. And boy, we took that round about 8 feet from us, but a little on the uphill side, so the shrapnel goes like this, you know. We got the dirt and no shrapnel. Had we been sitting up, it had got us. But that dog knew that round was coming. That's the sixth sense of a dog. It's hard to believe, but we have a number of incidents in our outfit where if they listened to the dog, they were all right.
The Belgians were good soldiers. They had a company commander. His dad was the Minister of War at the time. And the way I understand it, one of the guys told me that about half of those troops were convicts, let out of prison. And if they served 7 years honorably in the Belgium Army, they were got relieved of their prison time, or got honorably discharged from that also. And there were some pretty nice fellows with the Belgium Army there. I got to know several of them.
It didn't make any difference. If they wanted you to take an airplane and go someplace, or haul in fuel or haul in ammunition, you knew that there was somebody on the other end of that line that needed it. And there wasn't any question about not going. It was trying to save somebody else because they needed whatever you had on board of that airplane. We did a lot of airdropping and fuel and ammunition to guys that were trapped. And well, if we got shot at, we didn't know it. Or we didn't want to know it, let's put it that way. On the other hand, if we were to take a load of ammunition or 55-gallon barrels of gas, it was to the tank division or a tank unit or somebody that needed that fuel way up north. And then if they had a load of something that they wanted to come back out, it was usually wounded. And we, as I said before, we'd bring them back to Kempo, K-14, and then they were transferred. Usually, the wounded were not accompanied by nurses or doctors. They were walking wounded.
Servicemen were, they followed orders back then. Nobody, everybody did their jobs pretty well, you know, and I don't know, you know, law and order meant a lot out there. And you didn't want to make many mistakes because everybody depended on, you know, the different things, you know, like they depend on us to keep these planes in good shape, and we worked on them, you know, rigorously. We did a good job. We did, you know, best we could, you know.
Your trust level is very high. You count all of them for your protection, and they count on you.
I think that the enemy, or the Chinese, had lost enough soldiers in daytime battles up to that point, you know, that I went over there. I think the Marines and they took care of plenty of Chinese troops, and it just got to be where if you couldn't see them, you know, they thought you couldn't kill them, you know. I guess, you know. Then all night long there was some of the companies would send up flares, two parachute flares, and all night long these little chutes would be coming down with the phosphor flares, and you get enough of them going, and it lit the place up like daylight, you know.
And everything seemed to move at night when you were moving the position. When one company was coming off and another company was coming on, you'd always do that at night so the enemy couldn't see your troop movements.
They walked us. At night and during the day, they'd shove us somewhere where the Air Force couldn't see us.
One night they fired, I think each mortar fired a couple hundred rounds, you know. In our company, you know, and there were four mortars in our company. And they probably fired, maybe not quite that many, but probably 600 rounds during the night, you know. And that kept the Chinese back away so they wouldn't overrun us, you know. And you'd sit up all night and wait for the company commander to call mortar fire or artillery fire. And so we got to sleep a lot of times late in the morning, you know, in our bunker. We were all in bunkers, you know.
One day a big, tall, lanky captain walked in and he wanted to know if he could get some money. And I said, yes, sir. And I looked over his pay record and I said, well, I can give you $200 right now if that would be fine. And he said, sure. And so I did and got him checked in. And after he walked out, one of the other guys said, do you know who you just waited on? And I said, yeah, it's Theodore Williams. He said, you know, that's the ball player. And it was. And he came in a couple, three times. And then he went to Korea. And he actually, I think at one time, had to crash land a jet plane.
Once a week, we had the privilege of walking down the hill about 2 miles. And we could tap into the creek. And they had the ability to warm that water up. And we could take a shower and get clean clothes. And I did that every week because walking 2 miles down and 2 miles back, we were in shape to do that anyway. It wasn't a tiring effort at all. And as a matter of fact, it broke up the monotony online and you got clean clothes and you couldn't hardly turn that down. But you didn't have to go if you didn't want to. And we had to shave out of our helmet. That was our bucket. See, the helmet's got two parts to it, the helmet liner and the steel protection. Well, the steel protection is what we used as our wash basin.
That's a big thing in your life over there, communications, because you don't have any recreation. So if you're in, there's about two things you can do. There's probably the club down there, the officer's club, NCO club. You can go down there and drink if you want to, but if you're not inclined to, maybe you're going to write letters. Well, I opted to write letters. And actually, even though I was engaged at the time, and I wrote to my fiance every day, every night. I'd probably send the letter every third day, see, but it's like a diary. But then we'd swap different, all these other guys, they had sisters or cousins or something like that. For something to do, we wrote to some of those. So at one time I was writing to six different girls besides the one I was going to marry. So just things like that to occupy time, find out what's going on, get some news, and letters are important, you know. My wife was still in high school while I was over there because when I met her, she was rather mature, but I found out when I went to her birthday party, which was the second date, that she was only 15. I was robbing the cradle, you know. Well, anyway, so then that was her 16th birthday. So she was in high school all this time. And if you've been in high school, you know the temptations that come with it. You know, I'm sure she turned down a lot of dates because I know all of her friends too, you know. She did, she turned them down. She was true blue.
Loving a soldier. It's loving a soldier. The boy you adore, and hating the world, yourself, and the war. And though you know he's far away, you love him more and more each day. Loving a soldier is bitterness and tears. It's loneliness, sadness, and well-founded fears. No, loving a soldier is no fun, but it's worth the price when the battle is won.
A And those guys every now and then getting the Dear John, which, you know, those things were serious. We had guys that would volunteer for the most hazardous duty they could get after they'd get a Dear John. Or they may go off drinking, you know, they weren't worth anything. Or they may head off for Sewell every chance they get to the where the prostitutes are down there, you know. It was a serious thing to get turned down. So the girls that changed their mind after they left sometimes created some big problems, and they killed a few guys, you might say.
Most of the time the guys would drink beer and dance. They had a big, Yokosuka was a real big Navy landing place, and they had a real big beer hall there, and they have dances right in there, and the Japanese girls would come and they'd dance with you and stuff, you know, and we had a lot of fun as far as that goes, you know. But I suppose, you know, most of them drank their share of beer, you know, but you can't blame them. They had 10 days to have fun, and then they did it to the max, you know. So most of them were broke about the third day, so we didn't have a lot of money, you know. They didn't pay us a lot, but we enjoyed ourselves, you know. And we took pictures, and we had tours. We'd go out, you know, we couldn't go very far, but we'd tour around a little bit, you know. We rode rickshaws, you know, guys would pull them by hand or by foot, you know, and we got a kick out of that, you know. And they were, most of the Japanese people were glad to get the pay, you know, just take it, you know. I remember one incident where we were downtown, and we told the boy son, we call them boy sons, they're pulling this little rickshaw, and he said, "We got to get back ship, boy son, right now." So then he hurried up, and he said, "Faster, boy son," and he was just going for all he was worth, you know. He got down to ship, and then we said, "You got to go back uptown, boy son," you know. And he'd look at you and wonder, "What are you guys trying to pull?" You know, but it was just, you know, guys are ornery, and they'll pull stuff like that, you know. So
the Chogis were the 60-year-olds and older, and the Katusas were the military South Koreans. They were their soldiers, and they worked with us because they had to interpret, and they could speak the Korean language. And most of us could get by with Edo Shipshaw or Kochi Toshi or Toksan means large or big. And we could talk a little bit with them to get around, but they knew more English than we knew Korean. I mentioned that we were quite often mortared about lunchtime when we would get our hot meal. And those Chogis I told you were so helpful. They would set up the gear to wash our mess kits. They'd have a big, scalding 20-gallon bucket of water that we could dip our mess kits in to make sure they were sterilized. Well, one time the mortar came in and hit those steaming hot mess kit washing containers, and it also hit this Chogi in the jaw, a shell of shrapnel, and one in his knee, and it was amazing. He was dancing on one leg, holding his one leg up and holding his jaw with his other hand, and he was all the time hollering, "Itai, itai, itai." That's how they say, "Ouch, it hurts." And I felt so sorry for him because they exposed themselves to fire all the time, those Chogis.
That was such a poor country. You had to kind of feel sorry for them, but actually the run of GIs over there kind of took advantage of them, you know. And, well, you'd hire guys to help you out, you know, Korean. Some of them were laborers, and they hardly gave them anything to carry logs up on the front line to make bunkers out of. And you kind of made fun of them, you know, but those people were struggling. I mean, they had a bad time of it over there.
Yeah, I remember coming in on this little rickety train I'm telling you about. There was these little orphans running around, and no shoes on, snotty nose, begging sea rations. And we were throwing sea rations when we got off the ship because we didn't know the next place we were going to eat, you know. We threw them to them kids. And then later on, after the war was over, then there was a lot of organizations locally that gathered food for the Korean people. And we went down to a school down there and presented those kids with, we made cocoa for them and then presented these, this clothing, you know, child's clothing. And in a way, it was a little discouraging because you divided it up, and then after the kids on the way home, the big kids take it away from the little kids, sell it on the black market. But we tried. We tried. But the little kids, pathetic.
One time I went into an island off the southwest coast of Japan, or of Korea. The island was Jeju-do, and they were orphaned children. And the Catholic sisters there, Korean, had agreed to take those orphan children. Now their parents were Korean. Where the parents were, I have absolutely no idea. But we hauled in food, we hauled in clothes, we hauled in anything. And I remember the one or two times that I went in there, each time the children would line up along the runway, knowing that we were bringing them something to eat or something to wear. And after we chopped the engine, got the engine shut down and started unloading the airplane, the kids were all over the place. Well, yes, you bet they were grateful. I think the nuns were grateful too. However, we were never there long enough to receive any personal thanks or anything like it. We didn't really care. We knew the kids needed the stuff. And we were all ready to go back for another load, right, really. It was one of those things is kind of help your brother, I guess. I don't know.
And when everything stopped, that final day, I mean, it was like everybody wanted to get rid of their ammunition, arms. It was boom, 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 back and forth. But at midnight, it just turned quiet. That was the end of it.
In the last 12 hours before the truce, the artillery started throwing everything they had at each other. I mean, they sounded like they were trying to burn them guns up. And every time they'd fire this battery behind us, our little tent would just go whew, like that, you know. And towards the last, we could see the Chinese artillery coming in, the incoming stuff down the road about a mile. And that whole valley in there was just powder smoke. And noise, you couldn't imagine the noise, you know. And it didn't look like it was possibly going to be a truce. It just could never be that quiet again. It looked like it intensified, you know. By the time, but when it come midnight, all of a sudden it was quiet. Just deathly quiet. Nobody said anything, they just looked at one another, you know.
And then in the next week or so, we started moving all of our equipment back 1,000 yards. Both sides in the talks said that both sides would move their lines back 1,000 yards. And all of that in between, as it is today, is no man's land.
The next morning after the truce, the Chinese soldiers and the American soldiers are out swapping cigarettes for souvenirs and that sort of thing. Now, can you believe that? That actually happened. They were out there to see one another. A few days later, then the people behind the big brass, you know, put a fright into them and scared them that they shouldn't do this. But spontaneously first, that's what they did until they were warned not to. And then they didn't trust one another after that, but that was the first reaction.
We had quite a party after July 27th. Went offline and went back a couple miles and set up a camp. And then things got what they call chicken, you know. So it wasn't that bad, but it wasn't that good either. But, you know, I was lucky I got out of there.
We didn't know the truce was signed until we got into prison camp. And when I got there, that's where I met this fellow from White Lake, and then I ran into my second cousin. He was just a mile from me when he got captured 30 days earlier. In the meantime, my folks, nobody knew whether I was dead or alive. or just listed as missing in action. When they found out I was okay, they quit thrashing grain for a whole day because I was alive. But I've had a life and a nice family. And I guess the reason I went into so much when I got home, I always felt if I could have helped some of them guys, they could be with us today. But I guess since I got home, I put myself into fire departments, EMTs, and Knights of Columbus and Legion, always trying to help somebody. Because them guys helped me.
Our unit was deactivated in November of 54. And then the dogs were sent to Japan, retrained for sentry dogs. They weren't abandoned like they were in Vietnam. That was a terrible, pathetic thing that happened over there. The Air Force says it will never happen again. Dogs are not going to be treated like common equipment. But that was the rules and regulations those days. But ours were a little more fortunate. We couldn't bring them home as much as we'd like to and tried to, probably. But that's where they went.
After they signed the armistice, and probably about, I was in the mortar squad for 5 or 6 months, and then I got wind that they wanted somebody in the 3rd Infantry Division band. And they came around, and their band was looking for guys. And I used to play the trombone in high school. And by golly, I went down and I got accepted. So, and that was pretty good duty. And after the war was over, you know.
The time that I was over there, you know, I was concerned about the group I was to look out for and myself. And I wasn't paying attention to what was going on in general. But now after I get into history, I find from actually 3 different sources that are unrelated that our unit, when it arrived in Korea, cut the reconnaissance casualties by 60%. And that's a good feeling, a feeling like you accomplished something, because there's a lot of guys that are alive today because of us.
But there was a lot of little things like that happened every day, you know, little things that just kind of don't think of them so much then, but then now you think about all that stuff that you went through, you know, kind of, you wonder, you know, it was kind of out there you're like one big happy family, seems like, all these guys, you know, they work together.
I guess a lot of people don't realize why we were there. I guess I feel very lucky that I was one of them that got to come home and have a life. And I had a very understanding family that put up with a lot when I first got home. If I lay down on the floor, or like when we first got married, you didn't dare touch me, because I'd just come unglued. Or they had a bayonet in our back all the time when they were marching us. And I guess it took a long time to get over it. And I couldn't talk about this for years. Just been a few years that I've been able to say a few words to other people about it.
I'm sure the United States did the right thing then to try to stop communist aggression, because they had to run over South Korea, and who God knows where they'd have went then, you know. Vietnam would have probably came earlier, you know, and all those countries would have got run over.
At the time General MacArthur was relieved of the commands in the Far East, I think the American public supported him. You can remember his return to Congress, and old soldiers never die, you know, they just fade away. And but I think probably people now understand that he was going to get very, very aggressive with the Air Force in bombing the Chinese. And politicians knew that this might possibly set off World War III. And probably in retrospect, maybe President Truman did the right thing. I didn't think so at the time, though.
You know, being in the service was fine. I wouldn't give that up for nothing. I think everybody should have that experience. Some could take it, some can't, but I enjoyed the service life. I'm glad when it ended. I wasn't one of those that was ready to re-up. Some did, very few, but some did. But it's an interesting life. It's a good experience of life.
I'm glad I served. And I don't think I'd want to do it again, but I have no regrets about it. Yeah, I learned a lot, and kind of makes a man out of you, you know.
And I think a lot of those guys came home, and I don't think they got the recognition that they should have.
I feel real humble that they're honoring the Korean veterans now. I just wish all of them could be here to receive that honor.
We'll be right back.